Yeah. Alrighty. So the Twitch stream should be up. Let me just double check on my stream if it's working or not. And if you go to twitch.tv/dice, you can also see if it's
Yep,
working.
I'm just refreshing that now.
Same here. Testing, testing. 1, 2, 3.
Yep, I can see myself
here.
there.
Bacon has never been this fast. Racing has never looked this delicious.
This is me testing 1, 2, 3.
The bacon
testing 1, 2, 3.
It's bacon you can eat. Get one at Taco Bell.
Hey Carla, how's it going? Can you see us?
Bacon has never been this fast. Racing has never looked this delicious.
This is me testing 1, 2, 3.
I think I hear us. I think we're good. Let me increase the audio on my end. So, hi everybody, this is John with the Academy of Interactive Arts and Sciences. And with me today is Sam Barlow. So,
hi.
Yeah, so we're going to be playing today, like every week, through a different game and talking to various guests, as we always do on the Academy Gaming Hour. And today we're playing two games. We're playing Silent Hill Shattered Memories, and we're also playing Her Story, both of which Sam has worked on. And, you know, we're going to talk to Sam about both games, seeing some insights, and getting a feel of, I guess, your motivations and inspirations behind creating both games. So if for people not familiar with you, Sam, could you give a little bit of background into how you got into the gaming industry and what you've worked on so far?
Yeah, sure. So so worked in games for somewhere between 10 and 15 years now. And it was something I kind of probably always wanted to do. I was always interested in, you know, as a kid, I'd make my own text adventures and, you know, kind of play around with BASIC and type-ins and stuff. And was always, you know, really interested in games and kind of, as I grew older, got interested in kind of narrative and how interactivity could help that. And then just didn't really consider that as a kind of career option. And after university, I did a couple of years working in the kind of software industry for a kind of semi.com company. And after the bubble burst, I found myself back in England trying to figure out what kind of job would best suit me. And I had a friend who at that time was a programmer for a games company. And he suggested that I could get a job as a games artist because he kind of knew that I did art stuff and could use 3D packages. So I think I applied to every games company in the UK and two of them got back to me. And that was kind of how I got started in the industry. So I very rapidly shifted from art to design, mainly because I wouldn't kind of shut up talking about it. And so kind of Serious Sam, The Next Encounter, I think was the name. Which was like a GameCube version of Serious Sam. And then worked on a bunch of other games, kind of similar work for hire stuff. And then with Silent Hill Origins, that was kind of a cool break for me because another studio had started work on that project and things hadn't gone so well. And so my team then got to take that over and kind of, you know, a large portion of the money and time had already been spent on that project. So it kind of gave us leverage to say, hey, we need to change this. And right, I'm going to rewrite the script. I'm going to change the story. We're going to flip these things around. And, you know, no one had to give permission for that or anything because it was, you know, time was against us. And so we had to make these kind of quick, hard decisions. So it was a chance to kind of jump in there on a franchise like that, that, you know, is known for its storytelling and its atmosphere. And whilst Origins was not very ambitious in those regards, it was kind of, you know, trying to recreate the feel of the original Silent Hill game. It was just a chance to get stuck into that kind of material. And, you know, we turned out a game that was kind of okay. So after that, we kind of then got to kind of take it to the next level. So with the game we're going to see tonight, Silent Hill Shattered Memories, that was probably the first chance I got to kind of from conception create something and create a kind of concept which was kind of entirely of our own making and exploring some of the ideas that I'd always been interested in. So I was kind of active in the interactive fiction community in the kind of late 90s, where there was a lot of very interesting exploration into narrative, into the kind of how you frame the narrative, what kind of protagonist you can explore, lots of tricks being played on the player. And so these are things I've always been very interested in. And this was my first chance to actually try and explore some of those ideas. And you know, the project was pretty successful. It was a very hard project because we had lots of things we wanted to do. I remember when we first pitched it, so we had a kind of new producer join at one point, and we kind of pitched him what the idea was, and he looked at this list and he said, there's kind of 10 things you're trying to do here, which no one has done before, or which are very risky. Perhaps we should just, you know, trim this list down to 2 or 3. But it kind of felt like this game was going to be our only chance to do a lot of this stuff. So it's like, look, we're just going to try and do everything we can. I think it's a Warren Spector quote where he says, you know, he'd rather have a massive failure than of not trying. It was kind of that feel. It was like, look, we're just going to do all these cool things we want to do, and then just push for it. And, you know, I think a lot of the stuff we did actually pull off.
That's cool. And it was, you know, but on the Wii, it was a very ambitious game on the Wii, being one of the few mature games on there. I guess, what were you very proud of in the end in terms of the final gameplay, and maybe what were some things that weren't in the final cut?
I think the interesting thing is the thing that we're probably most proud of in retrospect, and which I think a lot of people talk about when they remember this game, is kind of the overall package of the story and the way that's told. So it tells this story which has a kind of big cathartic twist at the end, and everything we did in the game was trying to set up that ending, was trying to lay the groundwork so that when that ending was kind of dropped on you, it paid off. So, you know, very similar to what you might see in a kind of traditional Pixar type film, you know, with heavily worked in layers of imagery and just ideas. But what we were doing in Shattered Memories was we had this kind of frame narrative involving psychiatry sessions, and we had this layer of game mechanics where we were psychoanalyzing what the player was doing and using that to then kind of make small layered changes to the actual experience. And all of this was a way of, on some levels, making the player feel like he was personalizing it, like the character Harry Mason on screen was a reflection of them, and that they were kind of crafting their own version of him. And that was something that then in the kind of climax of the game is kind of paid off and used to kind of make one of the big points of the story. So those aspects of trying to tell a story in a kind of traditional media way, in that we had this kind of linear story we're telling and we built up to it and we had this big ending where everything was paid off. But at the same time, using all of the tools we had interactively to actually put you in this story in a way that you couldn't in traditional media. I think that's kind of how people remember it.
And sorry, let me test my mic again. I know people are having problems hearing me. Testing 1, 2, 3. Let me know if you still can't hear me. Hopefully I fix it. I'm not sure. But yeah, the psychoanalysis and the narrative was very fascinating in this game. And I guess working on her story afterwards, did any of these lessons in Shattered Memories kind of pay off in terms of your development of her story?
Yeah, I mean, I think they both have these, or they both share an interest in, so with Shattered Memories, you have the psychiatry sessions, which are a series of interviews. And then in her story, the whole game revolves around this series of police interviews. And I think in both cases, I'm very interested in those scenarios, because I think there's a lot similar between a police interview and a psychiatry interview, in that they are both formal settings. There is this formal relationship between the person asking the questions, the person answering them. But at the same time, there is this attempt to make it feel informal and relaxed. And have the person speaking kind of spill their kind of life story or whatever. So coming at that from a game angle, it's quite interesting because you have this rigid set of formal interactions. At the same time, you have the kind of more touchy-feely organic stuff. I think one of the big inspirations on some of the aspects of Shattered Memories was there's a text game by Andrew Plotkin called Spider and Web. And that has this this narrative, which is a somewhat unreliable narrative. And at some point you realize that the game you're playing is you telling the story of how you, you're kind of an espionage character, how you infiltrated this secret laboratory. And every time you screw up your recollections, you cut back to being interrogated. And the thing I remember really, really admiring in that game is, because of this situation, because this person is interrogating you, all of the dialogue in that game was reduced down to kind of yes, no answers, which meant that it didn't feel artificial. There wasn't this challenge to actually have the two characters talk to each other. And as a player, you kind of then were able to just kind of seamlessly get on with it. And that's one of the things we carried over into Shared Memories, was when you have these interviews with the psychiatrist, everything is kind of reduced to you saying yes or no to his questions, or answering using these little games and cards that he has.
Yeah.
And that was a nice way of being able to have these kind of character interactions and have the player have this input into the game without some of those barriers that you'd have where you're having to kind of select dialogue from lists, or, you know, choose the sentences which most match what you're trying to say.
And in terms of narrative design, I guess it's you play around a lot, both in Shattered Memories and Her Story, with, you know, character agency and with some, I guess, you know, a twisted narrative, obviously. What are your opinions on how narrative has evolved in gaming and gameplay? Do you think it's come a long way since, obviously, you know, the retro days, or what do you think we can do better as game designers?
Yeah, I mean, I think certainly, I guess, the expectation and the investment in narrative has come on. So, you know, even the most kind of blockbustery of blockbusters now will have a huge budget devoted to the writing team, you know, to the motion capture. You'll have very big name stars and stuff pulled in, looking for strong performances. So on that level, people kind of expect a lot of story content in their games, and people are expected to have a lot of, you know, quite an interesting story wrapper around games. I think in other areas, things haven't come on so much, perhaps. And I think as well, as the harder you look at this stuff, the more you see how cyclical stuff is. You know, there were kind of storytelling experiments that happened in the 80s and 90s that were doing things that have kind of been forgotten, and were doing very interesting things. I mean, that period that I talked about in particular, in the late 90s, within the interactive fiction community, I think there is still stuff that was done then and ideas that were tested out then that no one else has done in kind of, you know, non-text games or in kind of full 3D games. I think the bit that I'm most interested in, which kind of feels underserved to me, is exploring exactly what the gap is between the protagonist on screen and then the player who's playing him. And I think for me, all narratives by definition have this kind of distance between the audience and the characters on screen. And a lot of the more immediate art forms, so, you know, particularly cinema, really plays this kind of tug of war where, on one hand, you're really trying to immerse the audience in the action. You're really trying to make them at points feel like they are that character. And, you know, there are certain camera shots in where you're essentially seeing through the character's eyes or seeing through another character's eyes. And you know, the use of the kind of real-time scenes and stuff will really place you in that. And that gives you this intense emotional, you know, reaction and kind of a real strong empathy. But at the same time, you have framing devices and you have all sorts of abstractions and strange things that go on that are there and serve to remind you that what you're watching is not real, that this is a work of art, that there is, you know, there are layers of themes, and, you know, you're able to kind of sit back and contemplate what you're seeing on screen at the same time that you're responding emotionally to it. And I think that is even more interesting when you get to video games, because all the tricks that people have evolved in cinema, in novels, that kind of play on that boundary and kind of try and use the player's expectations to draw them in or push them out of the work. Suddenly in video games, because of the interactivity, there can actually be a kind of back and forth there. There can be some level where you're kind of, you know, you're doing even more interesting detailed things with that. And I guess a lot of my frustration with storytelling in general in video games is this kind of sense that it's kind of not just the player is always right, but it's kind of everything is focused around the player and kind of validating what the player is doing and kind of amplifying the player's actions. And a lot of it is to kind of to the end of having the player feel so immersed into a game that they kind of forget they're playing a game almost. And, you know, so there is a very strong feeling among some people that characters such as Gordon Freeman in Half-Life are an ideal player character because he doesn't talk, he doesn't do anything, you can't even see his hands, you know, he doesn't do anything to remind the player that it's not them. And his level of agency in the actual story is diminished to the level that there is no kind of contradiction between what's going on. You know, players can, you know, players essentially take a ride in Gordon Freeman, and there is no disparity between them and Gordon Freeman. And what that does is kind of, it allows you to observe a story, but it doesn't have what I think is most interesting in say, particularly in cinema, where particularly in, say, suspense movies, and so, like, I'm a big fan of Hitchcock, so particularly in the work of Hitchcock, a lot of the time, the player, the audience will see the characters on screen and they'll be inhabiting those characters, and through those characters they'll be desiring certain outcomes. And, you know, that is the art form of suspense, is to give the players, the audience, enough information that they are kind of predicting what's going to happen and they're desiring certain outcomes. And then when the filmmaker carefully thwarts those and the character is thrown into some more deadly scenario, a more negative scenario, there's kind of a level of guilt on the part of the audience, and they kind of redouble their efforts and they become enmeshed in this action that's going on. And I think that kind of thing is something we can do even more so in video games. And I think for you to do that, you do need to have real characters on screen that kind of, you know, this idea of the kind of holodeck version of yourself, where essentially it's just you walking around this world, is something that I kind of struggle to envisage working fully. You know, even without having that technology at our fingertips now, you know, a simple thought experiment shows me that I struggle to see how you would tell what I would define as a meaningful story if it's kind of just the player walking around improvising and talking to characters and having them react, and, you know, fluidly as if he's actually there, you know, because that to me then becomes more like a theme park or something than an actual kind of story experience.
And that's the difficulty, I think, with games, right? Like you were saying, there's a struggle between game narratives. This is interesting to talk and play this game. the struggle between, I guess, like you were saying, hold on, let me pause the game for a second. This isn't working. The struggle between, we had a J.J. Abrams and Gabe Newell talk on D.I.C.E. a couple years ago about this, where, you know, Gabe was talking about the freedom, like you were saying, that a Gordon Freeman would have in the game, while J.J. Abrams was making fun of that, the fact that you can jump on someone's head while, you know, someone's having a very serious speech to you. And then there's the other side where the struggle seems to be, you're creating these very heavy narrative-focused games, and yet sometimes you may be foregoing gameplay, or you may be foregoing an experience that's too much like a movie. How can you balance between those two, or what do you think is the best way to balance between that, which is still a game, but it's still a rich narrative experience?
I mean, the one thing that I think causes us huge headaches in video games is, and this potentially comes from the kind of holodeck vision, is that in video games we are obsessed with continuous space, continuous time. So, you know, the kind of ideal video game, and to some extent Silent Hill Shattered Memories is an attempt to deliver on this. There's, you know, when I was a teenager, I was obsessed with the Looking Glass games, right? And their kind of ethos was that they are simulations. And so, you know, you're dropped into this world and then it plays out. So, you know, in Shattered Memories, there's no loading screens, there's no kind of menu screens, everything is kind of in the world. And I think that's kind of one of the things that creates the biggest problems for us, because I think so much of storytelling takes place in what you don't see, or what is hidden between the lines. So, you know, again, to go back to cinema, you know, you have a medium there which is based around the technology of filming something and then showing it up on screen. So it's about, you know, witnessing and capturing things on screen. But the actual craft in what we call a movie these days, in this the art form that's developed, is in the montage. It's in the edit. It's in the cut. It's in seeing a reaction shot from a character and you not seeing what they're seeing.
Mm-hmm.
And there is this whole huge off-screen space where a lot of the actual story happens. And that's when your imagination comes into play, and that's when you actually create the kind of the complexity and the interesting story.
Mm.
And I think a lot of the problems we have in video games come from the fact that you are just present all the time in these environments, that there is no kind of gap for the imagination to jump in. And I think then the video game itself has to fill all those gaps, and that can fill the kind of experience of the video game and the story with a lot of the kind of mundane. You know, the kind of gag is that, you know, in movies you never see people going to the toilet or anything, right? You know,
mm-hmm.
How many times does Jack Bauer go to the toilet in 24 hours? and in video games, you know, the Easter egg is you are allowed to go into toilets and you can press the buttons and flush all the toilets and do all this kind of silly stuff.
Mm.
And I think, you know, if you look at a game like, so a game that I think is very, very clever, is 30 Flights of Loving.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, that is a game which takes the concept of montage and cuts and throws that into a video game. So when you're playing that game, although the controls are reduced and stuff, you actually have, in the moment, quite a lot of agency. Certainly as much as you would in, say, Half-Life 2
mm.
or something like that. But you keep being dropped into these kind of Tarantino-esque non-linear scenarios. And so you're dropped into a situation and you're now doing two things as a player. You're reacting in the moment to the scene. So if it's a chase, you're running, you know, mm-hmm. if there's blood on the floor, you find a trail of blood or whatever. And on the other hand, the other part of your brain is out of the moment and is just thinking, how does this fit together? How does this jigsaw puzzle piece fit together? Well, that person who's lying in the puddle on the floor, weren't they my friend? You know, and you're trying to put these pieces together. And I think that's a really good example of how, without breaking that kind of immediacy and the kind of involvement that you have in a video game, it gives you a lot of what's cool about narrative and other mediums. And, you know, it creates that gap, it creates that space into which your brain can, you know, fill and kind of create that wonderful thing of kind of being emotionally in the moment and then reacting intellectually and thinking about stuff.
Hmm.
So I think, I mean, that's you know, one example of how that could work. I think certainly with even with Shattered Memories, we are trying to do this a little bit, where it's kind of a subtle thing in the game, but obviously we have, you know, so on one hand we have the in the moment pure emotion of you are this character Harry Mason,
mm-hmm.
and he's looking for his daughter. So that's a very primal, understandable thing. And we have this Wii interface where you have the flashlight on the Wiimote, which is very intuitive, and, you know, suddenly your hand is essentially in the world.
Yeah.
Whenever you make phone calls, you're using the Wiimote. So we have this element where everything is very much about putting you in the moment. You know, there are no loads. You physically have to open every door in the world. So we're trying to make it feel like this contiguous real space. And then every now and then we'll cut out to the psychiatry sessions. And there's this frame which kind of breaks that narrative suddenly and engages you intellectually in trying to figure out, are these interviews happening in the future? And so are they talking about what's happened? So what, you know, now what, there's that huge gap between the kind of stuff we've just been doing and what's happened. And then, of course, because of the supernatural psychological element of Silent Hill, you're kind of trying to second guess that. Well, this is what Harry's seeing. What's actually really happening? What is this a manifestation of? And then we did some little things in the game as well. So quite often when we cut out to the psychiatry sessions and we cut back again, we'll respawn Harry in a slightly different place. So it's not like you're just taking up where you left off. It's like actually Harry is off doing his own thing almost.
Hmm.
And there are the little moments where as you're looking around the environment, you're looking at stuff and Harry will make some comment, which again kind of breaks that kind of Half-Life 2 rule of not having the character speak, because that can create this kind of conflict.
Yeah.
So in little ways, we were trying to create that gap here. And then for her story is very much an extreme attempt to push that idea. So, you know, in her story, although you have an entirely static narrative in that, you know, you are looking at video clips that in no way react to what you're doing. You know, mm-hmm. these are static video clips. Because you're seeing these clips and you're seeing small little clips at a time, and you're having to infer the context of the clips because you're getting them in a strange order.
Mm.
These are clips of a woman speaking to detectives, and you never hear the questions the detectives are asking. So again, you've got this extra layer where you're trying to infer what was the question that she was being asked, and you have this intellectual challenge of placing it all together, trying to come to a kind of solid conclusion as to what has been happening, what are they talking about. So, you know, that for me was taking these ideas and really pushing them to the fore in something like Her Story.
Interesting.
And by removing the kind of the 3D world exploration aspect of it, really just kind of focusing the player and their imagination very much on this aspect of using your imagination to kind of really create the story.
Hmm. You know, out of curiosity too, I noticed with, you know, like you were talking about with Silent Hill Shattered Memories, and even with Her Story, you use the medium in interesting ways, whether it's the Wiimote or it's the computer interface, which I thought was very intriguing. Do you figure those in at the beginning of creating your game, or does it come story first, then gameplay, or what's your creative process like?
I mean, for me, it generally starts very much with a high level. This is the gimmick's the wrong word, but this is what's different about this game. This is what we're going to do different structurally, or with the controls, or, you know, with the, you know, some kind of clever mechanic. And yeah, so that always kind of happens, and so that's exciting me as a game designer, as a writer who's writing interactive stories. You know, that's the bit that gets me excited. This is different. I don't think anyone's quite done this before.
Yeah.
Yeah, so with Shattered Memories, it was making a game that psychologically profiles you, and using the hardware of the Wii to create all these interesting immersive bits and pieces that we're going to combine with that psychiatry session to make this overall experience. And then, yeah, with Her Story, it was, this is going to be a game in which you watch video clips from police interviews, and you're interacting with this database where you're typing in words to retrieve the clips. That was like, okay, I kind of get what's interesting about that structurally. I've never seen that before. And then once that structure is kind of in place, then I start to kind of assemble the story. And it might be that there are bits and pieces of story floating around in my head already. And it very quickly then shifts from that thing which initially got me excited now is essentially just the tool which I'm using to explore these characters. And at that point, very much, there's usually like a large amount of research and just going off and immersing myself in stuff. And then kind of coming out at the end of that, there's very much these characters who are living in my head. And the game is just the way to let these characters speak and get these characters out there.
I see. You say that you are a big fan of film and cinema. I'm just curious, do you consider yourself always to be working in games, or would you ever want to also work and explore other mediums as well?
I guess this is something that kind of comes up fairly often when talking to friends, because I have friends that work in movies and TV and novelists, and it's a weird question to ask, because often it comes down to kind of practicalities of in these different mediums, what is the audience size that you can address? What is the shelf life of your product? So, you know, making video games, you tend to be quite jealous of your friends who are putting out novels, because in 10, 20, 30 years time, their novel is still going to be just, you know, to some extent, just as readable, even if it's out of print. Whereas, you know, video games age very quickly, but then they counter with, I know, but actually the audience of a first print novel versus, you know, a popular video game is quite different. And I think for me, it always comes back to, because I've dabbled in other bits and pieces, but it always comes back to this thing for me where even when I've gone away and kind of written screenplays or got really deep on, you know, that kind of storytelling, it always comes back to the more you look at these other medium, the more you look at the static medium, you realize just how heavily interactive even the static stuff is. So like say if, when you're watching a film, you're reading a book, so much of it is based on the kind of projective parts of your brain. It's based on giving this information to your brain, so your imagination kicks in and you feel like you're in the moment, and all that kind of reptile brain technology that's there to kind of predict and you know, pattern, see patterns in things and everything, that is all being leveraged by this stuff. And so I guess, and then just the more that you kind of come to understand this, the more exciting it seems that we have these interactive mediums, that we can go in there and we can actually create kind of call and response, and we can actually kind of feed off that process. So I think for me, that's what kind of brings me back to video games again. And I think making her story was kind of a decision I came to through just, I guess, becoming slightly frustrated with the process of kind of working in the traditional console publisher area, and just how hard, especially in the current climate, one would have to work to get to try out some of these interesting story ideas or play with how we're telling story interactively. And, you know, it just came to the point where it kind of felt, looking at the marketplace and looking at what was achievable in the kind of indie space, that, hey, I'm just going to go off and I don't need anyone's permission to do some of this interesting work. I'm just going to go off because this is what is drawing me to games. This is what is, you know, this is what's making me passionate, is trying to explore this space. And so, you know, her story is very much me going, right, this is this kind of aspect of video games is really interesting to me, so I'm going to zoom close on that and do an extreme exploration of that, and, you know, that's going to allow me to satisfy my curiosity. You know, it's potentially useful for other people to see this kind of extreme data point.
And so how was that experience, going from, you know, working in a studio environment to you know, an indie environment? Did you enjoy the process? What were the pros and cons behind it?
I mean, I guess on some levels it was somewhat similar, in that often the kind of early stages of making a larger video game, oftentimes because of circumstances or luck, there would be a kind of reasonably lengthy upfront process. So the kind of last two big projects I worked on, you know, I was able to spend, say, around 6 months on the kind of the paper design, on that kind of research stage, kind of sketching ideas, staring into space. So projects like Shattered Memories, by the time we kind of ramped up the team, there was a pretty tight design on paper in terms of, this is what this game is about, these are the core systems, here is the kind of outline of the story, here is the visual imagery for the artist to explore. And, you know, so with her story, that was a kind of similar process, except I just didn't have anyone sat at a desk next to me to talk about what was on TV last night, or you know, ask them to make me a cup of tea or whatever. So I think obviously you kind of miss the social aspects of working in a larger studio, and, you know, having people to immediately bounce ideas off, and then you kind of quickly, Twitter becomes your kind of surrogate office. But then I think the difference with her story was moving into the phase where actually things were going to get done and things were locked in place and I was moving forward. I guess the big advantage there was I wasn't having meetings where I was having to justify things. You know, I wasn't having to pitch marketing departments on whether this was going to work and which demographics it was going to play to. It was very much, And obviously you can be your own harshest critic at times, so it was much more about satisfying my own kind of questions about how the game was going to play out and how it was going to work. But it was definitely quite freeing to know that I was the only person I was answering to. And that, you know, if I kind of felt pretty confident about something, if I felt that the kind of feel I was getting from this game was kind of had some sort of magic to it, then that was what drove me. And, you know, I'm quite driven anyway. So in the circumstances where that process, actually having to, you know, get past green light committees and gatekeepers and stuff, I think, you know, looking back over the projects I've worked on, usually I've been able to get across those ideas and move them through the process without, you know, them being compromised too much. But there's just a lot of effort expended, you know, and, you know, trying to make a video game is hard enough. And, you know, having that level of just kind of expenditure of effort of having to convince people and organize people and kind of, you know, get things through those various processes, I think can at times, you know, take away a little bit. But so, you know, that's definitely been freeing.
So one person did ask on Facebook, if I can find the question here, Luca Darko was asking specifically if you're going to do a follow-up to her story, but perhaps even a bigger question is, are you going to continue to work in the indie scene, or would you go back to a studio? Do you know what's next for you?
I think that initial decision to go indie and then make something like Her Story, I think was definitely a product of what I call the current climate. So it kind of feels like, say, at the height of say the 360 era, so when something like Bioshock came out, whatever you might think of Bioshock, it felt like at that point we had this kind of this cultural thing we were grabbing onto, and it was like, look, Bioshock demonstrates that we are this culturally relevant medium, that we're doing things that are interesting, and obviously it's a reasonably commercial product, and it felt like there was a little bit of a kind of a momentum behind products like that, hey, this is the kind of interesting product we can make, and, you know, and Shattered Memories was kind of part of that, and so it kind of felt like if the marketplace can support products like this, and if there's a desire to make more things like this, then that's going to be very interesting and healthy. But I think that as those products became a bit more expensive, and as we approached what at the time felt like this kind of precipice before the PS4 and Xbox One were revealed and put on sale, that suddenly kind of a lot of the publishers hit the brakes, and you know, there were a lot of products that were cancelled, or kind of delayed or modified or whatever, and now the climate amongst the kind of bigger console publishers, there are these far less titles being made. They are much more conservative in a lot of aspects. You know, they are very much, rather than playing to that idea of something like a Bioshock, where there is a kind of cultural value to it, it doesn't feel like we're in that space anymore. It feels like they are playing to a safer demographic. They're kind of giving the early adopters what they want. They, you know, these are very much entertainment products of a certain type. So part of me going indie was a feeling that it was going to be very hard for me to work on the kind of projects I wanted to work on. So I think absolutely if that changes, and I think it's changing every day, you know, there's this kind of power shift and the scale of budgets between what you might call indie studios or kind of higher tier indie studios is kind of shifting around. So I think for me, it's always going to be about working on an interesting project. And clearly having the support of a larger publisher, having a bigger budget is going to enable you to do some things you can't do on a much lower budget.
It's interesting when you say that the climate of these big consoles have, you know, gone away from the stories, and it sounds much like the movie studios that we talk about nowadays, where, you know, we talk about sequels and we talk about, you know, the summer of sequels versus the indie community. Do you feel there's a parallel between those two things going on?
I think there maybe is, but I think the kind of the love affair between video games and Hollywood kind of feels like we skipped a few steps. So as much as, you know, if you look at Hollywood and you talk about the kind of ridiculous franchise machines now, and, you know, the kind of strip mining of comic books, and I read today that the new Minions movie cost $70 million to make, and they spent $600 million in the marketing. You know, at that point, that stops becoming a movie, and it is just you know, this kind of global thing. It's just this franchise. But at the same time, there is still this inbuilt thing within movies where, you know, you have prestige movie projects. You know, each studio has its Oscar slate of Oscar-worthy films, and there's obviously a very vibrant level of kind of independent movie production. And then, you know, as a kind of offshoot of that, you have television, which is obviously becoming, you know, there's, you know, some people feel there's like kind of a new golden age of television, where there is very interesting stuff happening in television now, where actually the kind of movie budgets are reappearing within the kind of the cable TV areas and stuff like that. So there's always been a kind of a healthy ecosystem, I think, there. And you know, the whole culture almost of the prestige picture and the kind of Oscar-worthy movie kind of stems from the movie industry having an innate need to prove its worth. So, you know, when movies first started, they were very much the kind of a lower art form, and there was a lot of, you know, they had a kind of tawdry kind of end of peer vibe to them. And so there's always been a desire within the movie industry to project externally a kind of more positive idea and show that they are a kind of worthy art form. And it kind of feels like video games don't care as much, because we've already kind of skipped to the point where we're the entertainment product that makes all this money. And, you know, all the headlines will be video games bringing in more dollars than the movie industry, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, the kind of, in the kind of modern world where everything is that bit much more commercialized, it almost feels like that's all we need to do to justify our existence. So, I don't know, I think it feels like that aspect of modern movies, of the franchise and of the, you know, the sheer scale of effort, where, you know, you read that comic book movie X has, they just hire 8 writers and have them working in parallel, and then they just pick the bits they like, you know. And it's, so it's kind of somewhat creatively bankrupt. It doesn't feel like they're kind of valuing the creativity. I think we've seen that and said that is the way forward, that sounds really good. And we don't, you know, the frustration I have is we don't have, in the same way, that element where publishers are spending good money on products which have a very high kind of cultural merit as a way of showing the world our better side. I think, you know, you see publishers kind of showcase interesting indie titles and bits and pieces like that, but I think it's a very different scale to what you see in the movie industry. I think there's a much bigger disparity between the big budget blockbusters and then the kind of smaller games.
So
that might just be a product of the fact that we don't have potentially as many ways of selling things as you do in the movie industry. We have this issue with shelf life and stuff, so maybe that just exaggerates that kind of disparity more. I don't know.
Well, I'm going to pause for 1 second on that note, although it's not the best transition here. I do want to transition over to her story and talk a little bit more about that game as well. So let me see if this works. Let me know on the stream if this sounds too loud or not. I'm going to play around with the sound right here. Okay. So here we go. We're transitioning over right now. Hey, still there, Sam?
I'm still there.
All right. And so the music might be a little loud. I'm going to try to turn down the audio from my system.
Oh, yeah, I'm seeing her story.
All right. And so I don't want to show off too much of this game, because I think a lot of the experience comes from watching the videos, of course, and trying to figure out what's going on. But I guess, so you were saying that you created this game as a response, you know, kind of, to the current game climate. It's interesting that you used FMV, which is, you know, a very older format that many people don't use anymore. And I'm sure you've been asked this many, many times, why FMV? Like, why did you choose to use this type?
Certainly, and this is probably me being kind of hugely naive, but it was only when I was ready to ship her story and was showing it to people, and someone said, why did you make an FMV game? That I was like, oh, okay, I guess I made an FMV game. And I just, you know, I wasn't seeing it as being part of that thing. I guess I wasn't seeing it as being a genre at that stage. And because I was very much reacting to and thinking about video in the fact that it's just everywhere now. You know, it's you know, you're watching YouTube, you're watching Twitch, you're sending video messages on your phone. We're now consuming TV in a very different way through streaming stuff, watching Netflix, whatever. And so I very much had in my head the video as this thing. And I think at the genesis of the project was I wanted to make a police procedural game. And I'd zoomed in my head on the interview room as being an interesting thing. Because it was, if I zoom in on the interview room, I'm excluding all the other stuff that comes into police procedurals. So that felt like, you know, as an indie game dev, that's cool. But I've reduced my scope. But at the same time, I'm zooming in on the character interaction, the intensely personal, intimate thing that is this police interview. And that's something that actually is cool, because generally games skip over a lot of that kind of stuff. So that was what I wanted to do, and I was trying to kind of come up with, what is my angle on this? How does the game work if this is the area that I want to cover? And I think I just woke up one day and it popped into my head that I could use video. And, you know, I'd been watching stuff online and doing a bit of research. And, you know, YouTube is full of video footage taken from real police interviews now. If you watch true crime TV, you know, half the stuff you're seeing will be footage taken from police interviews with suspects and stuff. Obviously, you have things like Serial, where you're hearing kind of bits and pieces of interviews and things with people. And so I think what became Her Story was very much a reaction to that. It was like, okay, this thing now is seeing police interviews, seeing the video footage, and it, you know, it completely crosses over with that found footage thing. With, you know, you turn on the news now, and instead of seeing the news cameras reporting, it will actually be someone's cell phone footage that's been on YouTube and is now being shown on the kind of, you know, the 10 o'clock news. So that using video came from that, and it very quickly made sense in my head, because when the idea came to me, it was completely enmeshed with this idea of the database. And so here was a way of having video, but I guess the things that were problematic in the FMV genre in the kind of 90s, when you had your CD-ROMs, etc., were, you know, it's problematic because you're trying to give the impression that this is a real-time video game, but, you know, video can not be continuous. It can have breaks. It can be hard to branch it. One of the problems with the FMV games was a repetition. You very quickly got to the point where you were having to watch things again and again and again, and that killed this idea that these were live, real events happening. But suddenly, when I had this idea, and it was actually, you're looking into a database of video clips, I was, well, okay, the fact that they're broken apart makes sense. The fact that you're watching clips again and again is actually a virtue here, because now actually you're being asked to kind of infer layers of meaning in these clips. And so that then made a lot of sense to me. I think one of the things that I was reluctant to leave behind as well was making that transition from working on kind of bigger budget games to making an indie game. One of the things I really cherished on the bigger budget games was working with actors. So on Silent Hill Shattered Memories, on the kind of bigger project I worked on after that was cancelled. Spent a lot of time developing interesting characters, working with actors, capturing that performance, and that was kind of a key aspect of the experience. So the idea of, you know, dropping into an indie game where my story would be told through just text boxes or kind of little pixel characters or whatever, for me, that kind of felt like a shame, because I really enjoyed what actors and performance actually brings to storytelling. So when this idea popped into my head and it was like, okay, we have the video, well, bang, there we go. I can actually have an actor's performance in this game, and I'm not having to spend $2 million on motion capture. You know, I'm not having to use something which is not going to have the kind of the impact of a full performance. So that very much was then, that just made so much sense to me. All these bits and pieces came together. And so I think it was only, like I say, very much near the end of the process when I then saw it from that perspective of, here is an FMV game. This is a, you know, it's a dead genre. Oh, is this a new Night Trap? And I think at that point, it maybe even became a plus, because it was unexpected. Well, this is a dead genre. It's interesting that Sam has, you know, revived it. And because you have all those kind of negative associations of certain games, very quickly that kind of brings into relief why my game is different to those. And, you know, so for people writing about it, for journalists or people just anecdotally telling their friends about the game, they can go, well, this isn't like those old games because X, Y, and Z. And you know, very quickly get to kind of what is the meaning of this game.
Exactly. We're going to watch one clip, and just I'm just showing one clip, and so you guys can experience the rest. But here's an example of a little bit from the game. See if this works.
You think it's murder? I mean, clearly it's murder. What can I do to help?
Now, it sounds so short and it sounds, you know, it seems so out of place, but I think that's what creates some of the intrigue and a lot of the interest around this game. Can you talk a little bit about the actress, where you met her? How did you go through the casting process?
Yeah, well, the casting process was very fortuitous because actually I met and worked with Viva on an earlier project. So yeah, after Silent Hill Shattered Memories, the team moved on to a project called Legacy of Kain, Dead Son, Square Enix. And I worked on that for about 3 years before it was cancelled. And for the kind of the last year of that, we did various bits and pieces of motion capture. And so Viva was someone that we cast for a major role in that game. So having worked with Viva for about a year and knowing that we kind of worked well together and that she kind of enjoyed the kind of material that we were giving her, when I started developing her story, I think very early on, I kind of had Viva in my head. And that was partly because I remembered that when we did that initial casting session, so we saw, you know, lots of actors. We're in this small little room in Soho in London, and, you know, the actors are coming in. There's no makeup, there's no wardrobe, there's no set or anything. They just sit and they read their lines to a camera that we've got there for reference. And when Viva came in, she just, you know, she read her line, and it was just so good. And it came across so beautifully on the video camera that we were all kind of taken aback, and we exchanged looks, and we just said, thank you very much, you know, we'll be in touch with your agent or whatever. And I think at the time Viva thought she'd screwed up or something, because normally you have, you know, you ask them to do it again and you give them some direction and you kind of get a sense for how malleable they are as an actor. But she just nailed it. It was brilliant. And you know, even throughout the development of that game, I kind of always had that amazing casting video in my head, because it was so evocative, and that was just, you know, video with no adornments or anything, it, you know, and then trying to get that level of performance across into the 3D CGI was a much more challenging thing. So I think when I was thinking about this, and I was thinking that we have this character sat in this room and we're going to do it with video, my brain was very much latching onto, well, just remember how good that stuff was with Viva just in the empty room, you know, just wearing normal clothes, speaking to camera. So once I kind of put the early story together, I reached out to Viva and to see if she'd be interested, and she was. And then when I sent through the script, I think she then at that point realized that she was the only person in this, and the whole thing was on her shoulders. And she was surprised, because I think it was like a 300-page script or something because of the way it was formatted.
Yeah.
So I then very quickly changed the font size and got rid of the page breaks and sent it back. So it was 80 pages. So at that point, it felt manageable, even though that was still quite a tall order.
Yeah. I guess more of a fun question. Are there any secrets or Easter egg that you think people haven't found yet from the game?
I was very disciplined in, because obviously with the setup of the game where you type in words and then it will return clips, there is obviously a lot of scope for typing in some very obscure Easter egg and then getting something interesting back. But I was pretty disciplined about not doing that, because it kind of felt like that would cheapen the mystery, because actually the excitement should come from discovering the interesting things about this story. And it, you know, almost the premise of the game is essentially a series of Easter eggs. It's a series of kind of revelations and layers to this. So, you know, there are slight, tiny little nods here and there. But essentially, I was quite disciplined at trying to keep everything fairly straight. There is something that I think people think is some sort of Easter egg, where there's a feature in the game, which I haven't enabled yet, which allows people to share. So as you're playing the game and you're typing in search terms, you're kind of building up this big history list of all the things you've searched for.
Yeah.
And obviously that's quite interesting, because It's not just the terms that work, it's the stuff you tried that didn't work. And you can kind of, reading through this stuff, and especially when I was testing the game, it felt slightly, I've had this doing text games as well, and you get people's transcripts back. And because people are writing in language and they're kind of, you know, any thought that pops into their head, they're writing down, it feels almost kind of slightly intrusive that you're kind of spying into their head and seeing what they're writing down. Mm. So there's a small feature in there that will at some point allow people to share what they've done, and then I'll kind of collect everything onto my website, and you can kind of see, you know, what the collective unconscious has been kind of throwing into the game.
Yeah.
But somehow I think someone decompiled the game code to try and prove once and for all their theories or something, and I think someone discovered it. So I've already had a few hundred people trigger this command and had all their data fired over to them.
Are there any surprises of something that you're surprised people search for?
Well, I haven't. The work I need to do is I need to set up the thing on my end that will actually extract the search terms and dump it into an easy database for me to look at. Mm. So it's all just sat there waiting for them to see.
Oh, that's cool. The
scary stuff is when people who know me personally play the game and they immediately go, oh, I'm going to type the kind of things I think you would put in the game. And I'm like, whoa, that's dark.
Do you have any plans to continue the story by any chance? I know it leaves you off on kind of a cliffhanger, even though you know the story of kind of the main character.
No, I think I'm quite happy to... I mean, that's a very explicit choice by me. Mm. And this kind of goes back to what I was saying about 30 Flights of Loving and just this idea of not necessarily having to show everything and to create these gaps, especially in interactive work. And I think if you've been playing a game and if you're participating in the creation of this kind of story in your head, which you are in any game, I think there's, and I think you see this when, you know, for example, the ending they did for Mass Effect, where people got very upset that it didn't necessarily reflect what they felt they had done. I think there's almost a duty to continue to give some of that kind of story, keep some of that story in your head and in your imagination. And like a lot of my favorite stories have this element to them where you'll have the kind of overt closure in kind of the primary storyline. And then you'll have like a kind of B storyline, maybe with a kind of personal thread to it.
Mm.
And they'll leave that kind of ambiguously resolved. And I just love that because for me, you kind of get the cathartic kind of arc of the story through this kind of solid A storyline ending.
Mm.
But then having this kind of unresolved personal thread, for me, it means the characters are still living in my head. They're not, you know, I can't kind of tie a bow around them, put them up on the shelf and go, I'm done with that story. Where's my next story? You know, they're still there and there's still questions in my head. And, you know, for me, a lot of times the really good endings to stories, they don't feel like endings. They kind of feel like springboards that will kind of then shoot your mind off to going, right, you've now got enough of an understanding about these characters and you've seen enough of the events in their lives that now you can kind of have all these other interesting questions and they're going to live these interesting lives in your head. So for me, with this game, it's very much all of the story that occurs before the interviews. From my perspective, there's enough information, just about enough information in the game for people to have a pretty solid idea of what's happened leading up to these interviews.
Mm.
And that then gives them a lot of understanding about who this character is, what their motivations are, what has happened to them in the past, you know, a sense of what their struggles are or what the, you know, thematically what's interesting about this character. But then for me, the ending is very much about then kind of giving you this big kind of kick to suddenly throw in some other bigger questions and create this big gap for your brain to fill in, which you know, I'm very happy to leave up to players to kind of have their own idea of how that works and kind of, you know, have these characters still somewhat alive. And I think, you know, anecdotally it's worked because when I speak to people, they're like, I was still thinking about this game days after it. Most games, I finish them and I kind of move on. And you know, a lot of games outstay their welcome. So that point where you finish a game, you kind of, you've already necessarily moved on almost. You know, you've kind of sucked a lot of your enjoyment out of it. So the idea of her story of having a game that, you know, you can complete in 2-3 hours and finish, but then as you walk away, it's still in your brain, and, you know, even when you're away from the game and away from your computer, it's still having an effect and you're still thinking about it. That for me is a really kind of ideal scenario.
Cool. Just a couple more questions here. I know I'm taking up a lot of your time here, but
that's fine.
I guess one question is, in terms of, I'm not going to try to spoil anything, but the way you let the player finish this game, I think is very intriguing. Does that kind of play back to what you were talking about in terms of agency and the way you want to share the narrative with the player? Is that they can finish the game whenever they want to, technically, at a certain point? Was that a very, what inspired you, I guess, and kind of why, you know, why no 100% completion, no trophies, nothing in that arena, if that makes any sense?
This game was very interesting because when I started making it, I wasn't sure if it was going to have an ending. Mm. So I made a text game back in 1999 called Isle. And this was a game where you start off in a supermarket aisle and you have a few pointers as to what's happening to your character, and then you type in an instruction. So you tell them to do anything, you know, jump up and down, put some pasta in your trolley, speak to the character over there, tear your clothes off, scream, shout, winner. And whatever you told them to do, you got an answer, and that was it. The game was over then. It kind of took that one little pointer from you and then essentially would tie up that character's story. And the experience was you just repeated this over and over and over again, kind of slightly Groundhog Day, and your sense of the story was built up through all these alternate worlds you were creating, all these different outcomes. And, you know, in doing something, it might kind of cast light on a character's backstory, and then you would come up with another action that would trigger that. And speaking to people who enjoyed Isle, they all played it in a very similar way, and that they would kind of try a few actions out, go away, they'd come back later, try a few more out, and they really liked this sense that the game was never finished. They always felt like they could come back, try a new action, and discover some other little facet to the story they hadn't, or some new kind of fresh angle on the story they hadn't seen. And there were similarities with how Isle worked and how her story worked. So in my mind, I was thinking maybe it's going to be like Isle, where, you know, people are able to walk away knowing there's other clips there, and maybe come back at a later date and, you know, try and find some more clips, and that there's this sense of it kind of always being there for them. But when I started showing the game to people and discussing it with people, very quickly people felt slightly uncomfortable with that aspect. And I think there's probably a few reasons. I think the fact that we have this detective story frame, I think, is quite different. The fact that the narrative itself is concerned with several kind of layers of questions and revelations, I think, means people are kind of, they would be uneasy in walking away from the game because they didn't want to feel like they'd missed something, or they'd, you know, maybe there was one more twist waiting for them, or maybe there was just the one clip that would give them that piece of information that would give them a new insight or something. So the way the game ends is there's this kind of what I call a soft ending, where, without kind of spoiling it, the game gives you permission to walk away. And so it's kind of, the game comes in and says to you essentially, we the game think that you've now seen enough. So if you feel happy, if you feel like you've kind of got a handle on the story and you've enjoyed this and you feel like you've had a meaningful experience, you can walk away now, and don't worry, you haven't missed anything now. You know, you've seen enough, you can go home now. But if you want to stay late after school and work a bit harder, and if you want to come back and try and find more clips and do more stuff, you're perfectly fine. But it was, this was kind of the discussion we were having, was people didn't necessarily want this final bit of closure. They didn't want Poirot to walk in and say, this is now the game.
Yeah.
This is the story. And obviously there are some people who would like that. But what most people wanted was, they were like, I just want permission to leave the game. I don't want this nagging kind of doubt in the back of my mind. So if there's this thing which officially allows me to leave the game, I can now, and obviously when that happens in the game, there is this extra kind of question that's thrown in, which does allow you to kind of, you know, it gives you this kind of mini little cathartic kind of piece that will, you know, allow you to feel like the game is finished and you've kind of walked away. So that was a way of still having this very organic, player-driven, open experience like Isle, but just having this thing in there which gives you permission to walk away. Nice. And then, kind of interestingly, I think on Steam at the moment, I think it's something like 50 or 60% of people have seen the ending. Of all the people who've played it, which is a pretty good percentage.
Yeah.
But then beyond that, like 25% of people have actually seen 100% of the clips, which is a way higher percentage than I was expecting. Because I think when we tested it, there was only one of our testers who kind of was trying to find every clip.
Nice.
Most of them were happy to kind of walk away. So I was in my head thinking this is going to be, you know, this will be the kind of 1%, this will be the kind of the hardest of the hardcore. But I think actually, and you know, a few changes went into the game, and there's things like you can see on screen, there's this kind of grid which shows you all the clips that you've seen. And so you can look at that and go, oh, there's just a clump I haven't seen there, or, you know, there's more to find. And I think that the aspect of it being this kind of mystery storyline, I think those do combine to push people's desire to see it all for completion. It's not necessarily, I think some people have asked me if that's a gamer thing, like, you know, we are taught to want 100% games to find all the secrets. But actually, again, this is you know, purely kind of anecdotal. People I've spoken to who played the game, say on iPad, and some of these are people who've, you know, got in touch with me and said, I haven't played a game before, or I haven't played a game for 10, 15 years. This sounded interesting. I played it. Some of these people have, you know, emailed me to say it's 4 a.m. in the morning. I just 100%, you know, seen 100% of everything in the game. I couldn't go to sleep until I'd seen it all. You know, so I think it's not necessarily about being a gamer there. It's about, you know, I think it is this combination of, and there's kind of an addictiveness to it as well. I think a thing that's very key to her story's success that people don't necessarily realize until they play it is, as you were saying earlier, the clips are often quite short. And so there's actually quite a pace of interaction for the player.
Yeah.
You know, you type something, a few clips come up, you watch them, bum, 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 then you, oh, okay. And then you have, at any given time, you probably have more ideas for things to search for, more kind of potential lines of inquiry than you're able to type at any one time. So there's always like more things you're thinking you should be searching for. And like I say, there's this kind of nice kind of call and response thing where you're typing stuff, and even like typing a word and getting nothing. So you type a word and there's nothing in the database for it. Whereas that might be frustrating in another circumstance. Like in this game, that is almost kind of like a red rag to a bull. That's kind of like, in fact, I can't remember which journalist it was. Someone gave me this brilliant analogy, which I hadn't heard before, which I loved. And they were saying that her story to them was like playing battleships with words. And that, I think that nails that sensation for me, is that, you know, if you pick a square in battleships and don't hit anything, that isn't like a complete failure. That's a useful pointer because it kind of helps you, you know, decide where actually the battleship might be.
Totally.
So, I think that kind of addictive loop that's actually there within her story is another reason for kind of people wanting to kind of find every clip and fill out that grid.
Yeah, it's almost like a never-ending game of Battleship until you finish the whole grid up, because I remember myself staying up countless nights, and I couldn't sleep because I would continue in my head to think, you know, there's a search term in my head I don't want to forget, but, I, you know, there's only a finite amount of clips you can see at one time. So you would just keep on playing it over and over, and I had to finish it in the couple of days I did because it was just driving me insane. I guess just two more questions. One question, just personal. One of my favorite parts about the game is every now and then, I think when you hit a certain search term, maybe, or I don't know what triggers it, you see a reflection of the character, which I think is one of the creepiest moments in the game as well when I first saw it. Any inspiration behind that, or any reasoning behind creating that moment?
I'd say 50% of it is absolutely wanting to do that in every game I've ever made since I saw Metroid Prime. So there's, if you've played Metroid Prime, that is a great example for me of this thing that I'm obsessed with. Of, you know, Metroid Prime is this hugely immersive game, and you know, from the, just the way they used the GameCube controller sticks to make it feel like you're actually lugging around this kind of giant weapon arm. So, you know, it was a different control scheme to most first-person shooters, but actually it felt more... it put you in that role more. They had this thing which everyone now copies where they had the kind of edge of your visor around the screen, so all the UI was actually baked into your helmet. So it felt very much like you were in the shoes of this kind of this power suit. And you know, so much kind of lovely Nintendo magic in that game too. You know, just the noise the jump makes, just the way the camera works to really physically place you in that world. And you know, things like the seamless world, the lack of loading and stuff, these are all things that kind of directly inspired Shattered Memories. But then they do this lovely thing in that game. And you know, the storytelling is generally quite understated in Metroid games. Anyway, it's you are just a character alone in these kind of ruined alien worlds. But they do this lovely thing where if an explosion kind of happens close by your visor, the light bounces around and you see a reflection of your own face in the visor. Now in Metroid, you're playing as Samus Aran. And so it's clearly, you know, for most people, this is not your face. This is the face of this fictional character, Samus Aran. And it's just this weird moment. You know, it's not a moment where you're kicked out of the experience. And there's a technique that I admire, particularly in say Hitchcock, where and again it's this idea of on one hand really trying to deeply immerse your audience, on the other hand giving them this frame. And I think one of the beautiful things that Hitchcock will do is he will use humor or maybe some particularly strong visual imagery that's very it's not at all naturalistic, you know, it highlights the kind of artifice. And I think one of the advantages of doing that is by saying to the viewer, this is fake, and being honest about it, giving them this kind of thing, look, it's not you, it's Samus Aran reflecting in your face. It forces your brain, because at this point you're very immersed in the world and your brain is doing all this stuff to convince yourself that it's you that's enjoying this, and to kind of make the threats and the drama and the danger of these virtual worlds feel real to you. Your brain doesn't want to give up on that. So when it gets that kind of that clear piece of information from the actual work that's saying this is fake, it actually tries to incorporate that, and it tries to deal with it by redoubling its efforts to make things more realistic and authentic and immersive. And I think stuff like that is actually really useful, because I think if you don't have it, so for example, if her story didn't have any of that kind of highlighting that, you know, what world is this computer screen happening in? Who is actually sat in front of the computer screen? Then I think your brain would just have the room to start looking for things that weren't right. You know, I think you would naturally be looking for things that would kind of trip up, and then you would find a problem with the experience and you'd kind of lose this sense of immersion in it. So I think actually having those things which highlight the artifice of it, that kind of highlight the difference between the real world and the fictional world, even in things which are trying very hard to be immersive, I think actually have this kind of interesting role to play. And it was something that emerged in the case of Her Story out of early on. I think the game wasn't set back in the 90s. Early on, as I say, I was reacting to kind of modern YouTube culture. So early on, the game was kind of set in the modern day. And once I started to develop the storyline, there were elements to the story which felt somewhat historical, and it didn't feel like they played right if I was setting them in the here and now. So pushing it back into the 90s felt like, okay, it's in the last century, that kind of last millennium, in fact. You know, that kind of works. And then once it was in the 90s, then I kind of went deep on the aesthetics. So, you know, I actually, although the thing was shot in HD video, it was all then piped through original VHS players onto crappy old cassettes, then back into the computer. You know, then I just went to town on this kind of old school Windows desktop. And a big part of that for me was the kind of glare factor, was the kind of 4:3 CRT monitor, you know, the hum of that, and you know, and having seen that as well reflected onto the face of so many protagonists in kind of cop shows. You know, there's kind of the montage sequence you'll see where they're sat in the archive room, just looking through pages and pages of police reports or whatever, trying to find that one clue that will crack the case. I think for me, that was all kind of internalized as, you know, trying to communicate that kind of tactile visual of this CRT screen with its glare and the kind of strip lights in the police room and stuff. That was something I kind of really latched onto.
Very cool. I guess my last question is, just for people that want to maybe either go indie themselves or aspiring game designers, any suggestions or tips you would give them?
Oh, that's a nice open question, isn't it? This is how the police detectives catch people. You ask your suspect an open question, and then you just kind of let them talk themselves.
I learned well from her story, you know.
I mean, for my purely personal interests, I would say think very carefully about what you're doing in any game, really, with this relationship between the person sat on the sofa or in front of the computer or the iPad or whatever, and what's happening on screen, and just think about, you know, what is interesting about the difference in motivations. And I think there is this, you know, it's gone now really, but there was the huge thing of ludonarrative dissonance, right, which was a buzz thing for like a year or so, where people really love to point out, oh, this is stupid, the things the game wants you to do are different to the narrative. And I actually think that was a slightly misleading thing that people were picking up on, because I actually think some of the most interesting moments in games should arise out of a different set of motivations or a kind of different level of thinking between the people who are actually operating the game and the events that are occurring on screen as part of the game's narrative. And, you know, I think there's so much room for exploring that disconnect. And it's almost like, for me, when you're thinking about your setup and you're thinking about your story and your characters and what your game mechanics are, for me, the kind of the very interesting question to interrogate your game with is, what is that difference? What is different about the motivations of the player and the motivations of the character that they're controlling? Because I think if they are 100% aligned, then I don't necessarily, it might be a very interesting experience or a very cool thing. I don't think it's necessarily for me a strong story. And I think a lot of, when you think about trying to tell a story interactively, a lot of what you're asking yourself is, what is the difference between those motivations, and how does the player's interactions tie into that? When the player is making the choice to tell the game to do something, or is typing in some input, or is pushing the stick and is making their character do something, thinking in the moment, what are those motivations, and how is that something that our game is about? How do our game mechanics explore that? I think that for me is kind of, you know, a very fruitful place to put your head. And I think if people are thinking about that, then they're going to naturally create some more interesting experiences.
Very cool. So thank you so much for your time. Really, really fascinating a conversation. So thank you. For people that haven't played Her Story yet, it's available on Steam, Humble Bundle, correct?
Yep, it's on GOG, and it's on the App Store for iPad, iPhone.
There you go. So definitely do check it out if you haven't. And we'll be back next week at 3:30 p.m. with Day 9 playing Hearthstone. So thank you, Sam. And guys, we'll see you next week. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye.
See ya.